多謝曬各位。
Welcome. We take time out of the council meeting to host this press conference. We're here to talk about PAC report number 75A. Back in February, during the pandemic, we didn't have open hearings, and in February we put together a report regarding the chapters for which we didn't have any hearings, and we have submitted PAC report and number 75A, and there are three chapters there. Chapter 1, collection and removal of marine refuse by the Marine Department. Chapter 2, the EPD's tackling of shoreline refuse. And also Chapter 4, the HAD's efforts in facilitating building maintenance and management. And let me introduce my colleagues before we go into 75A. I'd like to say that for report number 76 regarding the Immigration Department and the Audit Department and the exchange of views across the media, I've written to the CS, Ms. Matthew Cheung, to express our concerns over the agreement and also the financial circular, Chapter 2, 2020. The agreement is that when a report is presented to the Council, any departments involved should refrain from making any comments until such time as the open hearings are over and done with, and then they can respond to the Director of Audit. The CS has written back to me to say that he will hammer home the message to the departments and bureaus that they have to comply with the requirements. And report number 76, we are dealing with the matter from a value for money perspective. We look at the implications on society, and we have to look forward. And regarding number 76, we don't see the merit of having any open hearing. We've listened to a lot of views, we have read the report, and we have raised a lot of written questions. They will be making a response, and it's only after a response has been made that we decide whether we need to hold any meetings or any open hearings. So this is by way of a report. Now back to report number 75A. Chapter 1 is under the purview of Ms. Eunice Jung, Chapter 2 under Mr. Paul Che, and Chapter 4 Mr. Lau, and the respective member will be explaining in brief what the chapters are all about, and then I'll throw the floor open for questions. Thank you. Chapter 1, I was in charge. It's about the collection and removal of marine refuse by the Marine Department. We have a couple of areas of concerns. The first one is the reporting of the volume of refuse. We are deeply concerned about it. Regarding whether this is reasonably accurate and the performance of collection, we are particularly concerned about the contract for collection and removal. They use the volume as the basis for estimate, and then they convert this into a metric ton, and this will be incorporated into the COR, the Controller Officer's Report of the MD. basically, for the MSW volume handled by the department, there is this discrepancy. It is only 19% of the marine department's record. And this is in previously it was 16% and 25%. And also the recurring expenditure, 16-17, it was $14 million. It's gone up by 150% to $101.95 million in 05 and 06. Also, we are also concerned about the management of outsourced contract. The Director of Audit is of the view that the Marine Department has not effectively handled or managed the contract for marine refuse to ensure cost effectiveness and also to ensure that the contractor complies with the terms of the contracts. The territory-wide contract and the typo contract are dealt with separately. However, there is some overlapping between the two contracts and haven't conducted any cost analysis. In the typo and also the relative cost has not been included. There are other issues like the contractors have not in accordance with the requirement, done the collection work effectively at the typhoon shelter and the promenade, and the monitoring has not been done well enough. There are two points on the part of the PAC. The first one is the contract for collection and removal of marine refuse. We express some particular concerns. For the territory-wide waters and typo waters, the two contracts are awarded to the same contractor. And since July 2005, and this has been the single contractor dealing with the issue. And there's been an increase in the value of the contract. However, the volume has not been increased. It has been an increase of 135.6%. It increased from $189 million to $447 million in 2017. And we express extreme concerns about this value. And the contractors should avoid using a single contractor to deal with the collection and removal of marine refuse. The Marine Department has to consider new measures to enhance the competitiveness of these tendering exercises.
You should also try to attract new blood, in particular young people, to the marine refuse cleansing industry. We also suggest that for monitoring of marine refuse cleansing and disposal services, we also express a serious concern in some areas, including in some patrol areas. The required frequency for conducting daily cleanliness patrols of at least once in a month could not be met. And also to the arrangements of some of the refuse collection points, we also see that they fail to comply with the requirements. So that is the briefing for part one. May I invite Mr. Jie to take us through the second chapter, please. Thank you, Chairman. So I am responsible for the government's efforts in tackling shoreline refuse. The Environmental Bureau in 2012 set up an interdepartmental working group on clean shorelines. However, as this is to step up the cooperation between departments in tackling marine refuse, we however, feel that there is no performance target or timetable for improving the cleanliness of shorelines. And that is a matter of concern. We also see that some areas along the shorelines do not fall within the purview of any government bureau or departments. And so there is no one to maintain the cleanliness of such areas. The working group should try to enhance collaborative efforts amongst the departments. And these include the AFCD, the LCSD, and FEHD. On the matter of shoreline cleanliness, we need to set a performance target. And there is no consistency in the performance targets. The Audit Commission has found two major incidents, including the Pok Hock incident and the pipe incident. The follow-up in the cleansing up the Pok Hock was very slow. And that is not conducive to maintaining the cleanliness of the shores. The AFCD and LCSD should enhance the patrolling of the areas. And for those contractors who could not meet the requirements, we suggest adding in penalties to enhance monitoring. As Ms. Yong said, we also see a problem with tendering. One contractor is awarded all the contracts, and therefore we should consider whether we should still continue the use of only one sole contractor. We want to minimize risk. And one contractor is quite undesirable from the perspective of risk management. Other than some of the recommendations mentioned, we also hope the Environmental Bureau can also step up the monitoring work. We want the installation of water stations in some of the areas, but it has taken a long period of time. We hope that they will be able to speed up this process. I now invite Mr. Lau to take us through the part on building management. Thank you. Oh, this is the part on the efforts of the Home Affairs Department in facilitating building management. So this is on how to assist the 3-nil buildings to set up owners cooperated. I'm sure you all know that we have many 3-nil buildings in Hong Kong. So with the implementation of Building Management Professional Advisory Service Scheme, we see it has been divided 3 stages, 9 years to try to assist 3-nil buildings. Only 536 OCs have been formed or reactivated out of 3,820 buildings. And the success rate is only 14%. So we are concerned about the HAD's failure in taking forward the Building Management Professional Advisory Service Scheme in an effective manner. We know there are many reasons behind why many OCs cannot be formed in 3-nil buildings. However, the HAD can still try to improve their work or to explore other effective channels to reach out to these owners. We have set out some recommendations to encourage owners of 3-nil buildings to set up OCs. We will try to reach out to these targets and to explore different channels to suggest innovative measures to enhance the success rate. We can also set up some guidelines or performance targets for the HAD. Well, we see that although some measures have been met under the scheme, the success rate is still not high. We hope they can try to improve the performance of the scheme. They should also maintain a proper database and statistics for the effective implementation of the scheme. We have sent out many questionnaires. However, the response rate is low. We want to try to improve the performance of the BMPSS contractors. And we also hope that HAD can also work with other departments to help the 3-nil buildings, such as the fire services. So we hope to give more authority to the HAD to better support 3-nil buildings.
Bridget, we have made some specific recommendations when the administration is regularizing the scheme. It will be more conducive to the setting up of owners corporations. Finally, I'm grateful to all the officials who attended our meetings, and we hope that we can enhance the work in this area. So there you are. We heard from the members the Marine Department, the ENB and the EPD, and the HAD, the Home Affairs Department, have given rise to some problems in terms of value for money. And also, we find that some of the practices unacceptable in terms of sound governance. A lot of these initiatives were tendered out, and there was no supervision, and there was no penalty. And the attitude that with which they approached the work leaves so much to be desired. We'd like to look forward. We highlighted all these problems, and we hope that all these departments will understand well enough that they have to be accountable to the members of the public, and they have to spend the money in a value for money manner, and they have to do the job in accordance with these principles. Any questions? Mr. Lau highlighted an issue, not just in terms of value for money and sound governance. It has to do with the safety of life and limbs. We asked the HAD many questions. This may not fall within their purview. This may not fall within their policy areas, but the HAD has to coordinate with other departments, and they are not doing a good enough job because the public safety falls within their purview. So we feel that the HAD and HAB indeed have to make amends, they have to make improvement in the services they render to the public. Unless you have any further questions. Right, let me say it a bit more, since you don't have any questions. In chapters 1 and 2, there are so many marine issues. The PAC is of the view that there are problems with the tendering, and the administration has not looked at the supply and demand. So in terms of the training of personnel and so on, there should be some studies to be conducted. They should go back to the panel. Now, this is a tendering exercise, and things can be terribly complicated with regard to marine efforts, and they had only one single tenderer. We may not be able to reduce the price by increasing the number of tenderers. The administration has to look forward and try to make sure that there will be enough supply. It's just like the property market, because of a limited supply, the prices will go up. And if you have to rely on one single contractor, if the government is making the tendering exercise too restrictive, then the tender price will be skyrocketing. The government should not simply administratively increase the number of tenders. The government should do something else. And I hope that the administration should take an extra step. We have to make sure that we can facilitate the obtaining of licenses, which is not easy. We have made available the recommendations to the administration. The work doesn't stop here. We will follow up on whether they are making any improvements to the issues highlighted by the various members. And we will follow up on these going forward. In some cases, we follow up for a whole duration of 10 to 15 years. So we will continue with our follow-up action to make sure that they will serve the members of the public from a value-for-money perspective and good governance perspective. And on Wednesday, we had a motion debate regarding the improvement of government policies. And this does tie in with the work of the PAC. Thank you all very much for coming.
Thank you.